Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. There are no apologies being received from members this morning, and Jamie Halkett-Johnson is joining us remotely. So our first item of business is a decision to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's response to our inquiry report. Our supply chain inquiry looked at the short and medium term structural challenges facing Scotland's supply chain and how the challenges and shifts in supply chains are impacting on Scotland's economy. The committee published its report on the 20th of April and the Scottish Government responded on the 4th of July. The purpose of today's evidence session is to consider this response and to discuss with the Minister in more detail the issues that were raised. So I welcome Ivan McKee to the committee, MSP, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise. He's joined by Andy Park, who's Head of Economics at Transport and Strategy and Analysis, Graham Cook, Deputy Director of Procurement Services, Karen Flockhart, Unit Head of Skills Planning and Sector Engagement, and Dermot Rattigan, Deputy Director, Manufacturing and Industries, all with the Scottish Government. So, as always, I'd ask members and witnesses to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, and I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for allowing us to bring a number of officials, but as you appreciate the breadth of issues covered in this this very comprehensive piece of work is quite extensive. And it's great to be back here since my last experience appearance in January, and of course, as you mentioned, my formal response to the committee's report in July. The global economic outlook, of course, has weakened considerably, and as the Deputy First Minister noted in the emergency budget review just last week, the whole world is facing a period of substantial economic turmoil, rising prices, soaring energy bills and the resultant increased financial pressure on public services are not unique to the UK. However, the UK government, as a result of Brexit, of inaction over the summer and the catastrophic decision to announce unfunded tax cuts for the wealthiest, has made the situation in the UK significantly worse. Against that backdrop, we have been regularly engaging with businesses and business organisations, and it's vital that we take all action within our power to support our businesses through these difficult times. Our National Strategy for Economic Transformation was published in March, and last month we published the delivery plans for the strategy's programmes. And those five strategic programmes remain right for the country, and their delivery focus builds the Team Scotland response we need to deliver change. As we set out in the programme for government in September, where we can, we are prioritising and accelerating actions to help people and businesses through the current economic crisis. In tandem, through the national strategy, we are continuing to build for the long term to strengthen economic resilience, including supply chains nationally and internationally. The committee's report is wide-ranging, covering the themes of people, place and product, and the Scottish Government's response sets out actions we are taking across a range of policy areas. Skills is a prominent theme in the committee's report, and the National Strategy Skilled Workforce Programme recognises the importance of national and regional skills planning to address skills gaps and shortages and to ensure we have a pipeline of skilled workers to meet the needs of a green economy. We're already taking action to improve our approach to aligning skills provision with employer needs through the Shared Outcomes Framework, and we expect the recommendations from the independent inquiry into the skills delivery landscape next spring. We've also undertaken evaluations of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and individual training accounts, and we expect to publish these reports this year. To expand Scotland's available talent pool, we've committed to launch a talent attraction and migration service in 2023, and I'm engaging with industry to develop a talent attraction programme for the rest of the UK. The National Strategy aims to position Scotland to maximise the greatest economic opportunities over the next 10 years, and we're at the forefront of delivering a just transition to net zero by 2045 with an ambitious interim target of 75% reduction in emissions by 2030. In relation to ScotWind, supply chain development statements set out developers' commitments for supply chain content, and we have been clear with developers our expectation of what must be delivered. I welcome the collective commitments made to invest an average projection of £1.4 billion in Scotland per project, which equates to more than £28 billion across the 20 ScotWind projects. We know that the manufacturing sector will be central to a successful delivery of the national strategy. And this sector's transition to low-carbon manufacturing will generate new, well-paid jobs, while the wide reach of the new National Manufacturing Institute Scotland will help to boost manufacturing research, development and innovation across the country. Since the publication of the National Strategy, we have launched a £25 million Low Carbon Manufacturing Challenge Fund, which is designed to build on Scotland's existing expertise, encouraging partnerships to come forward with bids that will encourage the adoption or development of low-carbon technologies or processes. We are using the levers at our disposal to maximise the social, economic and environmental impact of public procurement in Scotland, and in financial year 21-22 of just under 19,000 suppliers awarded public sector contracts across Scotland. 74% had registered on our system with a Scottish-based business address. And in October 2020, we published guidance on supply chain resilience and diversity, reminding public bodies of practical steps that should be taken to support supply chains and help reduce the risk of disruption to supplies caused by supply chain vulnerabilities and surges in demand. Robust and resilient supply chains are the bedrock of a thriving economy. We must take every opportunity to continue to strengthen Scotland's supply chains. I look forward to our discussion.
Thank you very much, Minister. You do recognise the breadth of the report, and members will look to cover many issues. We do appreciate you're not always the Minister who's responsible for those issues, but we welcome that you've brought support along with you this morning, so hopefully we can have a broad discussion. Could I just ask, so I suppose the driver for the report came from the impact of Brexit on supply chains and the pandemic, and now more recently we have the war in Ukraine and the pressures that has put on supply chains. And the evidence we heard, the committee, I think, you know, did feel that there needs to be more resilience within the Scottish system. There needs to be concentration maybe given on shorter supply chains, more local supply. The response we received from the government didn't really kind of take that broader view or that longer term view. We do recognise there's lots of work happening in different areas, but we didn't really get the impression that there was a shift or a way to think, how do we respond to these, the existing pressures, and, you know, we're likely to see future pressures given the impact of climate change and other kind of global issues. Is there a longer term strategy or focus to make Scotland more resilient?
Absolutely there is, and if that didn't come across in the reply, then that shouldn't have been the case. The supply chain development programme that we are taking forward is very much focused on identifying areas of the economy and supply chains where we can build more resilience and shift to having more capacity and capability within Scotland and manufacturing in particular, and that covers a wide range of programmes, including, of course, the work on Scotland to support the building of indigenous local supply chains for floating offshore wind. On hydrogen, we recently published a report that identifies opportunities for manufacturing businesses in the upcoming hydrogen supply chain. On construction, be it on the timber supply chain, off-site manufacturing for the construction sector, be it in life sciences, around about medicines manufacturing. Of course, we've just opened or about to open the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre down in Shannon, or across a whole range of sectors where we recognise there is opportunity for Scotland to further strengthen our indigenous supply chains and encourage and support Scottish businesses to take advantage of those opportunities. Of course, you and the committee will recognise that global supply chains are complicated, and clearly we're not in a position either from raw material supply situation or many manufacturing processes to be able to take over all supply chains. And I think it would be foolish to attempt to do that given the complexity of those current global supply chains. But of course, where we can, for issues of economic development, for issues of resilience, we seek to do that. And much of this, of course, is built on the response to the pandemic, where, as you and the committee know, we were very successful in building up an indigenous Scottish supply chain for PPE during the period of the pandemic.
The committee's recommendations does suggest that the supply chain development programme could be expanded, that it maybe felt, you know, I think you've spoken about future supply chains, whether that's in growth areas, you've mentioned renewable and life sciences. I suppose we also had some concerns about just the existing supply chains that people rely on every day, whether that's, you know, food products. We have become a nation like many other Western nations that depends on imports to a large extent, and we saw that during the pandemic, the disruption that came with that. Does the supply chain development programme include that kind of view? Is there a drive within government to look again at whether, you know, a reliance on imports is the right balance, and should we be changing some of that? Is that a view of government, or is that not a priority for...
Well, in terms of supply chain, as I said, the priority is to look at where there are opportunities, where we can be competitive, where we have the capability and the technology, and to maximise the opportunities for manufacture of products within Scotland. If you want to talk specifically about the food supply chain, of course, Scotland has a thriving food and drink sector, something we're very proud of. And my colleague, the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, is very focused on what we do to continue to develop that sector. And clearly that is, there's a number of factors that are related to agriculture more broadly, be it climate change, be it financial support or many other factors. But supply chains, of course, is a big part of that, and where there are opportunities for us to grow more produce in Scotland to support resilience, and that makes sense with the agriculture sector, then that is absolutely something we're focused on.
So is the development programme, is that a cross-departmental programme then? Does that...
Yes, it is, and it focuses on a range of sectors where we have identified that opportunity does exist. But that is absolutely open to adding more programmes to the collection of programmes that are considered as part of that work, where it makes sense to do so. And I'm very open for there to be agricultural programmes as part of that, though, as I do say that there's obviously wider factors that impact the agriculture agenda relating to financial support, climate change, land use, natural capital, biodiversity, etc., etc., that are all also part of that that policy area.
Okay. Can I just move on? I'm going to bring in other members in a second. I'm going to invite Gordon MacDonald to come in, but can I just move on to issues around labour market? So one of the things that came through in the inquiry was inactivity. I know we had a discussion about that when you gave evidence. We do recognise, you know, it's not a huge factor here, but it is a factor. And the 10-year economic transformation plan does say that it would systematically address Scotland's labour market inactivity challenges. So is there work being taken forward on that? The committee in its budget report has expressed concerns about the £53 million cut to employability services. We've written that to the Cabinet Secretary this week. But is there, through the economic plan, what is there timescales attached, or what is the... is there an action plan to bring inactivity back into the labour market?
Not only is there a focus on it and work being undertaken, we're actually delivering results. I think possibly for the first time, but certainly for the first time in quite a while, Scotland's inactivity rate is lower than that of the UK. Inactivity across Scotland was reduced by 20,000 over the last period, and the rest of the UK increased by 220,000. So now in Scotland, we not only have the lowest unemployment rate in the UK, we've also got the lowest inactivity rate, lower inactivity rate than the rest of the UK, and we've also got a higher employment rate than the rest of the UK. So it's still early stage, but we are seeing the results of that work. And as the rest of the programme rolls out, I've no doubt will continue to make an impact, a positive impact on those numbers, increase the Indigenous supply of labour to Scottish businesses. And in terms of the specifics on your question regarding the input side of this, the a prioritisation of resources across the emergency budget review, of course, had to take into account a wide range of factors. There are still £82 million being spent on employability support as we move forward, and clearly as we're in a position where a very tight labour market is in play, it's about understanding where best to divert resources to support not only labour supply but business support and wider support across society at a time where, of course, it's very, very difficult for many individuals, families and communities to keep their head above water with the cost pressures that exist. So I say we've got the programme in place, the national strategy is driving that forward, the details of that have been published in the project plans that were published at the end of last month, and we're already delivering results in that area.
But the project plans don't really include specific milestones or targets for an economic inactivity. And do you know, I mean, it's welcome that there's 20,000, the number's reduced, that's welcome, but do we know what the reasons for that has been? Has it been because of proactive engagement from the government, or is it about the labour market being so tight? And because the evidence we've heard during the supply chain inquiry and in relation to the budget has been that, you know, there are concerns about the cut that is coming in employability services and that it's a group. The businesses we heard from last week were saying it's a group of the workforce that they need support to engage with and to bring into the labour market. We're still hearing there's challenges there. And
yeah, there are challenges, and there's many reasons for that. The biggest reason for it, of course, is immigration policy. Without a doubt, that's the single biggest issue. And everybody will tell you that, businesses and everybody else.
No, sorry, I meant there was challenges in employing people who need that additional support to come into the workplace, so those who are economically inactive within...
Well, the biggest reason that businesses can't get people to fill the vacancies they've got is because of immigration policy and Brexit. That's absolutely clear. So within that context, we're doing everything that we can to be able to support that. And as I say, I point into the data, which shows that, of course, the tighter labour market is going to push numbers in the right direction in regards to bringing more people into the labour market. But if you compare and contrast Scotland's performance compared to the rest of the UK, we've been more successful than the rest of the UK. Our numbers are going in the right direction. The rest of the UK, they're going in terms of labour market inactivity in the other direction. So we believe that's a consequence of the work we've taken, be it in terms of childcare support, be it in terms of other activities that's happened to support, to employability support, to help individuals get into the labour market that otherwise wouldn't have been able to do so. And we continue to move that work forward because there's a wide range of factors that impact what is quite a wide and varied cohort within that 21.6% that are still inactive in the labour market in the 16 to 65 age group. So we continue to do that. As I've already indicated, there's £82 million being spent on employability support. And with all these budget calls, of course, everybody can say they want more money for everything. But as you know, because we don't have borrowing powers within the Scottish Government, because of the current constitutional settlement, we are having to match to run a balanced budget, unlike the UK Government, and that obviously puts constraints on what we can do. So those decisions have to be made. I think that was the right decision, and as I say, we're getting results, and we continue to invest significantly in employment going forward.
Okay. I'll bring in Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Convener, and morning, Minister. I wanted to continue the discussion you've just started about immigration. So in your July letter to the committee, you highlighted that the ending of freedom of movement could result in Scotland's working population decreasing by up to 5%. And then you went on to say that the UK immigration system is unresponsive to labour market requirements. So given we've had a number of changes in government since that letter was written in July, what discussions have taken place with UK ministers regarding devolving immigration as happens in other countries, or amending the Scottish shortage occupation list?
Yeah, I continue to engage with the UK Government, and I've got a list somewhere of the dates and times and letters that have been sent on that and a whole range of issues. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's a huge break on the economy. It's a very misguided policy. Unfortunately, it's a policy that not only successive UK governments over the past few weeks have continued, but unfortunately the opposition across the UK is, as was indicated at the weekend, has got a very misguided attitude and a very unhelpful approach to this policy area as well. So our position is clear. Scotland needs to be an open economy. We need to have free movement and be part of the single market, single European market. We need to have a much more flexible approach so that people that come here either to study or for other reasons that have got very, very needed talents are able to contribute to the growth of Scotland's economy and help fill some of the critical shortages that we have across the economy. We continue to engage with UK Government on that and to put pressure on them. We take every opportunity, you can be assured, to highlight that issue in ministerial engagement and other forums to highlight the need for the UK Government to wake up and take a more sensible and business-friendly approach to immigration.
And again, in the letter you sent to committee, you highlighted a joint letter was written to the UK Government from the three devolved governments, i.e. Wales, Northern Ireland and the Scottish Government, calling on a joint task force on labour market shortages to be established. Can you indicate how that's progressing and whether the UK ministers have engaged on this subject?
Finding UK government ministers to engage with has been a challenge over the past few weeks, as you can appreciate. But the response to much of that communication hasn't been responded to, and where it has been, we are obviously not of the view that the UK government is doing what they need to do to be able to address the specifics on these issues. And as I say, we continue to take every opportunity to press them on that, and their responses, unfortunately, have been less than helpful, if anything, perhaps going in the wrong direction, as we've heard from UK government ministers in recent days and weeks.
So given that all approaches, not only from the Scottish government, but from the Welsh and Irish governments, in order to try and address labour shortages in the three countries, have been, as you say, less than helpful, what can Scotland do in order to address these issues? There was talk about establishing a migration service for Scotland. Could you indicate what we can do, given that it's a reserve matter?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's work happening that my colleague Neil Gray has taken forward on wider international immigration to do what we can there within the constraints of the very restrictive immigration system the UK government's put in place, and that work is moving forward for the Talent Attraction Migration Service. And as part of that, I lead a group that's focused on talent attraction from the rest of the UK into Scotland. Scotland is a very attractive proposition. There are an average of about 8,000 people net. Average of about 8,000 people per year come into Scotland. So there's about 8,000 more come into work in Scotland and go in the opposite direction on an annual basis. We believe we can increase that number significantly by positioning Scotland within labour markets in the rest of the UK to attract more talent to come north. That's a programme we're working with a cross-industry body on from a range of sectors that we believe have got the opportunity to offer very attractive opportunities, employment opportunities for talent from the rest of the UK. That work is well developed. We've had 3-4 meetings with the group now, and we're pulling together various work streams that we're taking forward. So it's a great example of co-production with business and industry. It's something that's building on, I think, a very positive starting place, but something I think we can easily add many, many more thousands to that number and help to address at least some of the skills and talent challenges in the Scottish economy.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
I'm very well, thank you. This was a report and you've responded. It was about supply chain and logistics are clearly very important in that. The committee's report, and I wasn't on the committee at the time, but I've read the report and I've read your response. Wide-ranging, as we've said, but one part of it related to the logistics industry, and in particular lorry drivers. And we know during the pandemic that we could see there was a shortage of lorry drivers. That's actually been a long-standing issue, not just during the pandemic. So the committee referenced the two problems. A, the number of lorry drivers, we don't have enough. And B, the facilities that lorry drivers have to put up with. Sometimes they're at rank rotten. They really shouldn't have to put up with some of the facilities that are out there. I'm not necessarily talking about any in Scotland, but this is throughout the UK. What we need to know, and I think your letter references that, is what actually is out there. What is the offer for lorry drivers in Scotland? So we need to know what facilities there are. So my question to you is, have we actually started doing that piece of work yet? Because we've been talking about it for long enough. Strikes me it shouldn't be that difficult to find out what rest and welfare facilities are out there in Scotland. It shouldn't be difficult to know what the conditions are. We just need to get on and do it and then work with industry to improve where needed. And of course, the second point is we need to know how many lorry drivers we need. So a couple of questions there.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and there's a few parts to that, and I'll hand over to Andy, who'll pick up some of the facilities aspects and some more of the detail. But in general, you're absolutely right, of course, there's a challenge there. It's slightly less pressing than it was than it was a number of months ago, but as you know, there were issues with the authority and the UK-wide authority in terms of testing and so on, and that was a challenge back previously, and I think there's been some movement there, but there's more to be done. Another part of that, of course, is making those careers as attractive as possible. We've engaged very closely with the haulage sector to work and understand how we can do that. And part of that, as you say, is the roundabout rest and welfare facilities for drivers. There's also the issue of modal shift to try and get as much freight onto rail as possible, which, of course, lessens the need for HGV drivers to some extent at the margins, and also what we're taking forward to look at opportunities. Working with again a cross industry group that I lead for opportunities to do more direct shipment for freight that's going to and from Europe and beyond by sea, rather than it trucking its way down through the length of the UK, and we are looking at opportunities to expand the capacity to do that as well, which of course will help relieve some of the pressure on HGV driver requirements. But I'll ask Andy to maybe pick up on the rest and welfare aspects of this.
The strategic transport projects review 2, which we published draft report of in January, and the final report's due by the end of the calendar year, picks up that as one of the 45 recommendations. I think it's recommendation 38 of 45, but they're not in any particular order in that initial report. And we've been following public consultation over the spring. We've been working up what the priorities are for the immediate future. It's probably reasonable to say that the continuation of the work on freight facilities strategy is up there with other key things, and will be taken forward in the short term.
So just following up on that, if I could just ask you, Mr. Park, if that's okay, has that work actually been done to assess, you know, what facilities there are in Scotland, yeah, and what the condition is?
There was a limited amount of work done as part of STPR, but it needs much more to doing at this point. So we haven't done it yet, but it has been planned.
Okay. So to you, Minister, that, as I said at the start, that doesn't seem to me to be a particularly difficult thing to do. Somebody just needs to drive round the main roads of Scotland and call in places and have a look. No, it's not. It's not that tricky. We just need to get on and do it.
Great. You and me will get a truck, Graham, and we'll drive round one weekend and have a look. No, you're right. There's work to be done there, as you appreciate, that's a broader portfolio brief, but I undertake to follow up with the committee and respond back on the specifics of what's actually happening there and a timeline for taking that work forward.
Okay. So if I can follow up on that, convener. Just to move slightly into a different area, but we're still on logistics. I'm going to ask you about electric vehicles. I know it's not your brief, but it is logistics, and we do want to decarbonise transport. There is an issue. There was an issue that was highlighted in the recent report by the cross-party group on sustainable transport, and the issue is we saw during the pandemic deliveries increasing, so a lot more, so more vans on the road, fewer people, you know, people are switching their private vehicles to electric, but not in vans, so we're seeing more sort of petrol and diesel vans on the road, fewer private. You know, more electric private vehicles, and I think the issue there is we need to get that sort of modal shift in delivery vehicles, but we need the infrastructure there, and it's not there now. So what are we doing about that?
Yeah, I think that's obviously part of the transition, and it's a big focus, both in terms of transport for the modal shift and the net zero impacts of that. So we published the report on Scotland's electric vehicle charging market recently, and that identifies what needs to be done, but also recognises very much that it's something that needs to be done in partnership with the private sector, because the investment requirements is something that the public sector can do part of it, but the bulk of the work there needs to be done by the private sector. So the draft vision for the future of Scotland's public electric vehicle charging network sets out the ambition to work with the private sector to develop the charging network, but being clear about what is commercially viable that the private sector will pick up itself, and where the gaps are in that the public sector needs to fill in. So we've also announced the Electric Vehicle Infrastructure Fund, which has got a target investment of £60 million. So that is part of the work we're taking forward to do that. But you're right, that needs to move forward to enable that modal shift to happen. We absolutely understand that, and it's about working with the private sector to make sure the investment's in place to deliver on that. I don't know, Andy, if you want to comment any more on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's an excellent point about the increase in van use during the pandemic. I mean, we're still seeing whether that was a permanent shift, but it does look like it is in that direction very much. It actually ties into a whole bunch of things, including the 20% car reduction target, that what is a car, what is the light van, that kind of, these kind of ideas. So it's all stuff we're aware of. We are exploring various options as part of, or various analytical things as part of the 20% route map work. We've been exploring ideas on a kind of relatively small scale, but that could be scaled up around potentially setting something up around community van sharing for more rural locations, getting chambers of commerce to get the scale where an electric van could be bought for and used for a range of deliveries across a groups of businesses. So those things have all been looked at, and we just need to see how things develop as stuff recovers back from COVID. But it is a live issue for us. And you know, if you look at the private car kilometres, they've stabilised at slightly below pre-pandemic levels. But some of that has been taken up by van use. But it is that whole shift from retail to online sales and so forth, which was happening anyway, but has been accelerated significantly, although it's dropping back a little bit in the more recent data.
Okay. Okay, that's very useful. I'll maybe take that up with you, Mr.
Thank
Park.
You
seem to have a keen interest in the subject.
Absolutely.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay.
We'll make progress. Colin Beattie to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Mira. Morning, Minister. I've got a couple of areas I would like to explore a little bit, but just as a general comment, it seems to me that so much of the issues around supply chains and everything that goes with it seems to come back to the incredibly poorly managed hard Brexit that we've been forced to go through. And the knock-on effect of that just seems to resonate all the way through the papers that we've got here. Just coming to the specific questions, there's areas of specific skill gaps that have been highlighted to the committee during the inquiry, and indeed in other inquiries that we've done. And that's one of the areas is around digital skills. Now, in your response, you noted that a report on the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review is due to be published in the autumn. Can you provide any update on this work?
The STEIR work, the Logan report, I met with Mark Logan earlier. Last week to talk about the progress that's been made. So there's work obviously happening on the education side of that Mark's leading. Invested money in new computer science hardware for schools. We've invested in the Digital Start Fund and Digital Skills Pipeline projects. We've funded the Digital Extra Fund. So there's a range of support for digital skills in place. And in terms of the broader, and also the creation of the STACS, the Scottish Teachers Advanced Computing Science, which is a teacher-led organisation designed to spread best practice and advise us on implementation of that aspect of the STEIR review. So there's work happening there. The STEIR review, if you've read it, you'll obviously have read it, it places great emphasis on getting that education piece right first, and everything kind of builds on and follows from that, and recognises that there's much to be done there. So across the range of things we've identified, I think we're implementing, we're making progress on it. And as I say, I had a conversation with Mark just in the last few days to talk about that and other aspects on tech scalers and so on that we're taking forward.
given the complexity of the digital requirements of the market, it must be quite difficult to provide, we can't provide a one-size-fits-all, but we see from different segments of the market different needs, different priorities, a different speed of development in some things, if we can throw in the e-commerce and so on, the speed with which that's moving. How can we keep up with that in order to ensure that the skills that are being taught and passed on by our different agencies are right up to date and are giving the correct level of digital skills?
Yeah, I think you need to unpack that a wee bit to identify what it is we're trying to address and different aspects of that. In terms of what we're doing in schools, I think that's giving young people an appetite and a basic level of knowledge around about computer science, how it works and what careers in computer science can be like. And obviously, diversity and inclusion is a huge part of that, tackling the gender gap and broadening out the reach across other groups that we want to be more widely represented in digital jobs. So I think that piece of it is focused on that level, getting young people, giving them an appetite for that. Clearly what we're teaching them now and what they're going to be using in their career in 20 years' time is going to be very different, and we don't know what that's going to be. So I think that brings on the second part, which is how do people that are in employment and in digital jobs and others that are coming into that later in life, how are they brought up to speed? Clearly, much of that work will happen by the industry itself, because we're not in a position to say this is the code and language you need to learn for next year, or this is the networks you need to be up to speed on for whatever happens to be. So much of that is going to be taken up by the sector itself and working in collaboration with the sector to understand where that technology is going and what the latest technological developments are, and how we work with them is an important part of that. And the higher and further education system is increasingly tuned in to engaging with businesses to understand how we work closely together, and they've got the agility to be able to address and respond to those needs. So it's, as you say, multifaceted, because we need to also, across the broad range of businesses, where there's perhaps of SMEs and some other sectors, where there's a lack of even basic digital skills and awareness, that is also part of the agenda, to bring people up to a more basic level. So I think we're moving on forward on all those fronts at the same time, but you're right, it's a complicated and ever-evolving challenge. It's not just Scotland that faces that challenge, of course, everybody in the world faces that challenge.
Just to move on to something slightly different, we have a cost of living crisis. How is the cost crisis hitting Scotland's supply chain? How challenging are the energy and material prices which are increasing for industry? And are there particular sectors that are especially exposed to this?
Significant. There was an FSB report that came out earlier this week that highlighted the challenges, and some of the numbers in that are obviously concerning, because the vast, more than 90% of businesses are absolutely feeling significant pressure as a consequence of where we are. Much of that, as we know, is due to a whole range of factors. Brexit, you've identified, the Ukraine situation is obviously exacerbating much of that, including on energy prices, which then has a knock-on effect across a whole range of commodities. There are sectors, I think, which are more robust than others. Some of the technology sectors and some of the advanced manufacturing sectors are feeling the pressure, but not to the same extent as other sectors. So some of the consumer-facing sectors, retail, hospitality, leisure and so on, are finding that particularly difficult, and I engage with that sector and others. So I think it's true to say there's a range of different sectors being impacted in different ways. And of course, it's not only for those consumer-facing sectors an issue of cost pressures, as well as labour shortages and energy challenges. It's also potentially a downturn in demand as the cost pressure start to bite across the broader population, and people spend less money in those sectors. So we work closely with the sector to see what we can do to support there, and also work closely with the financial services sector, who from their position have got an overview clearly of data across businesses and consumers that we find very helpful to help inform our understanding and response to the evolving situation.
Now, clearly the Scottish Government is doing everything it can to support businesses, but how much is actually in the Scottish Government's hands the capability to make a truly significant impact on these costs? Are we a big player in that, or is it out of our hands?
Well, as you know, if you look at much of the levers, they are controlled by UK government. We wish that wasn't the case, but while that is still the case, we work within that that environment, be it on welfare and social security support. Social Security Scotland is doing a job which I think has been widely recognised by users of the service, has been very, very effective, but it only, of course, is focused on a small number of benefits, and in terms of the magnitude, the vast bulk of it still comes through UK government channels. So decisions on universal credit and so on have a significant impact on how people are supported. Energy policy, of course, is reserved, which makes it constrains very much what we can do. We are doing what we can, of course, with Scotland and other initiatives to not only increase energy supply but to decarbonise. But energy policy and many of the levers in that space are reserved, and of course borrowing powers are reserved as well. So the Scottish Government has already identified has to work within very constrained limitations, and not only that, the situation is unhelpful with regard to even understanding what those limitations are, because we find ourselves in a position now where the delayed UK government fiscal event means that we don't actually know what the budget situation is to allow us to be able to operate within that, given those constrained borrowing powers that we have. So you're right to identify that much of this is driven by levers that the UK government continues to control.
I mean, given the fact that this is a crisis, it's a crisis for all our businesses, are there any meaningful talks going on with the UK government and the other three nations, and Scotland, and of course, especially Scotland, in order to try and manage this, to reach any sort of common result, any improvement?
Yeah, as I said, there's been communication on a fairly regular basis over the past few weeks and months from ourselves, and often with ourselves as in Scottish Government in partnership with other devolved administrations to encourage, call on the UK Government to take steps and with regards to specific aspects of that, be that extending the period of certainty for businesses around about the energy price cap, be it supporting, as I mentioned, through the social security system, be it other aspects where we've called on them to take action. So, but as we've already identified, the turmoil within UK government and frankly the wrong turn and then U-turn they took on some of the taxation and other policies has been extremely unhelpful. To get responses that have been helpful and effective in terms of what needs to be done.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Hi, just picking up on that point before I move on to my main question. The most recent, frankly disastrous fiscal event, clearly we all agree will have an impact on existing supply chains, but surely it will also have an impact on supply chains that the Scottish Government will be looking to develop in the likes of ScotWind, and combined with these rising costs plus an inability potentially to attract key skills that we might need in terms of the labour policy and a limitation on proper borrowing powers. Is that something that concerns you as well going forward?
Yes. Yeah, of course it does. We are focused on doing everything we can, but as we've already identified, many of those levers, when you talk about Scotland, much of the energy policy, of course, our energy policy in general is reserved, so that challenge is what we can do there. And building those supply chains in an environment where you've got that uncertainty at macroeconomic level, lack of support, challenges on the skills side, cost pressures is obviously difficult, but we're in this for the long haul, and we work with those businesses to strengthen those supply chains and take advantage of that significant spend that's coming. Scottish businesses way through the work we've done to with developers to roll out the ScotWind projects.
Yeah, possibly it'll be picked up by other members, but it's clearly an area of interest to create a future as well. I wanted to ask about free green ports. Just an open question: what are you able to tell us about the current status and any timelines?
Aye.
Without seeking to compromise you, obviously.
I mean, the first point to say is that we worked through that process and we had our four red lines, and the UK government eventually came to accept that those four red lines were valid, and agreed with us that the Greenport project should be taken forward on that basis, around about net zero commitments, fair work commitments, equal funding, and two ports in Scotland. So we were happy we got that. We then, of course, went through the process earlier this year, which was a very robust process, and the teams working behind the scenes done a great job to evaluate those bids that came in, and we had hoped to make that announcement in the summer, but of course since then there's been a number of changes of personnel, government and focus, direction, etc, etc, in Westminster, which meant that because it's a joint government approach, and people say we should work more closely with the UK government, we are working closely with UK government, it's just them, it's just not quite clear who the UK government is at any given point in time, which makes it kind of hard to work with them. But we had hoped to make announcements in August. We're now in November. We still hope to make announcements very, very shortly, but we have been saying that for 3 months now. Yeah. The ball's not in our court.
Well, absolutely, with all the changes at UK government level. In terms of specific incentives, are you able to give any more flavour at a generic level of some of the kind of thematics, or again, is that all wrapped up under?
Well, in terms of Greenports themselves, there's clarity on what the offer is, in terms of LBTT, in terms of the UK government's commitments on NIC and so on. So that's already clearly identified, and it's the same offer. We managed to secure the same offer as they made to English ports. So that's clear. One of the issues around the margin on that is much of this was determined on fixed time periods with dates. Now, clearly, because of the delays, we're looking to see if some of those dates can be extended to make sure we get the full benefit of that. Part of the complexity, though, has been the Trust Administration's announcements on what were they called, investment zones, which then the new administration is having a look at that to understand where they want to go with that. So even under the Trust Administration, there was a lack of clarity on what an investment zone actually was and what it would deliver. At one point, it looked as if it might even have more benefits to that than to a green port or a free port, which was all a bit kind of strange. But we're waiting for definite clarity on that and what that process looks like, even if that still exists. So that's another dimension of complexity and uncertainty that we're waiting for some clarification from UK government on.
Yeah, I think my colleague Maggie Chapman is going to ask about investment zones, actually. My last question then was, there were concerns, and they continue to rumble around, about the potential for tax avoidance using green ports generally. I'm looking at a report from last year from University of Portsmouth, and they make the case in the journal Money Laundering Control over the misuse, and as we know that the UK loses $267 billion each and every year to money laundering and financial crime. I suppose, I mean, given that this area is entirely reserved and the regulation of to the UK government, I wondered if you had any discussions with them as to what steps they are going to take to use free ports not being used for tax avoidance, because, of course, that's a loss to ordinary people in the street in terms of doctors, teachers, nurses and public money generally.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a significant issue. As you rightly say, it's a reserved issue. It's one of the areas right about regulation that, as we move forward on the constitutional agenda, it's important that we're clear on where we would position ourselves and the opportunity we would take of having those powers and then following independence to be able to address those issues. And clearly we'd have a very different approach, and that's important that we take that work forward. In terms of the clearly free ports in England, the UK government will control those, and we can look at the effects and the impacts of that. But as I said earlier, our red lines round about the award and the operation of green ports in Scotland were very, very clear on a number of factors relating to net zero and relating to fair work, and also relating to controls to make sure that those dangers, which we're all alive to, were very much the process was such that it would ensure that wasn't a risk, or that risk was absolutely minimised. So we remain focused on it, and as we roll out the programme, hopefully sooner rather than later, you can rest assured that our efforts will continue to make sure that there is no degradation on any of those standards across that whole range of policy areas, including on tax evasion. Mm.
Last question, just to finish off this before we move on. In terms of conditionality, can I be optimistic that the businesses trading out of whatever Scottish free green ports are allocated have equitability at their core in terms of women-led businesses and women business representation in terms of entrepreneurship?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, in terms of the conditionality, we've been explicit on that, on the net zero aspects and on the real living wage and fair work agenda aspects, and that was a very important success that we secured in the programme. And it was great to see the bids that came forward. Not giving anything away, but they were all very focused on those aspects as well. They were very seized by the fact that that was an important part, a critical part of their offer. So that's, I think, we start from a good place there. More broadly, in terms of women-led businesses, in terms of other areas where we have an agenda to move the to move forward in entrepreneurship and elsewhere and tackle diversity and inclusion challenges. That's not explicit in the requirements, but of course it's something we continue to take forward across the whole range of economic activity across the whole economy.
And you can be sure I'll be continue to ask about
Indeed.
It.
Indeed.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Just before I bring Maggie Chapman in, the economic and activity figures that you quoted. So the figures, the ones that came out in October, which is, so the inactivity rate was 21.6%. This is 0.1 percentage points down from December 2019, February 2020, and down 0.2 percentage points over the quarter. So that it was a very slight percentage decrease, but that resulted in, you've said, 20,000 people, is that right?
Yeah, the total number is 21.6%, which is 750,000 or thereabouts.
Okay. So, yeah. And the difference with the UK figure, I think it's a 0.1% difference. I think you're 20.6 and
that's right, they're at 21.7. That's correct.
Yeah, so, so we're kind of, we were previously higher, we're now
we have been higher for quite a long time, and ours has been trending downwards and it's now going lower than the UK. Yeah.
But a 0.1% is the difference, and the percentage increase is quite slow, but it's equated to 20,000 people. That's
Indeed.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks, Claire. And good morning, Ivan. Thank you for being here, and thank you for what you said so far. You've probably part answered my first question around investment zones. We see in the last 12 hours or so that the announcements that they are likely to be scrapped. That the plans
I haven't even heard that. So there you go. I've been focused on prepping for this, and I haven't had So thank you for that information.
And the various conversations or various discussions around what might replace them around urban regeneration plans and that kind of thing. And I appreciate this is all a very movable feast. But I suppose what would be the priorities in your discussions with the UK government around the consequences for Scotland around, if we aren't going to have investment zones in the low tax, low regulation space, what would be your priorities for something if there was going to be an equivalent support for something like that in Scotland?
No, it's a great question, and I think it gives me the opportunity to talk through some of the background work we've done on this, mm-hmm. because in terms of engaging with the UK government on investment zones over the past few weeks, we had a good look at our regional economic policy direction, and there's some great work happened there. There's been the David Bell work that's been fed into the process. There's the work we're taking forward with the Regional Economic Partnerships, who I've met as a group several times, in making sure they're plugged into the NSET, the National Strategy work. There is the regional economic strategies that they are pulling together, mm-hmm. And that ties in with the work we've already done on regional prospectuses to focus on regional strengths in specific sectors and align that with our inward investment activity at a Scotland-wide level and how SDI takes it onto the global stage. So a lot of that is coming together in quite a coherent and helpful way, but most importantly, it's led and driven by the regional economic partnerships, who identify their strengths and work with us and the agencies to take that forward. So we very much saw enterprise zones in that light. It was how do they fit into that existing work, not something separate, but very much another tool that would help to drive forward that regional economic development agenda, working very closely with local partners. And not giving much away here because it's clearly not happening anyway, and this continues to be the policy, but our approach to that was to be to, as I say, work with reps to for them to identify how they thought within their regions, which sectors, which clusters, which regional geographies were most able to benefit from that, building on many of the excellent clusters we've already got across many parts of the country. And also the question around about our enterprise areas and what we do with those going forward, the existing, which we've kind of extended, but we need to make some decisions on to what extent we build on and develop those or refocus them, working with regional partners again.
Okay, thanks, that's helpful. And in some ways that ties into my second question, because you talked there about the important role of regional economic partnerships and using that local knowledge to identify, you know, sectors, clusters, those kinds of things. I think there's potentially a tension between the local, regional and national levels of both investment and identification of sectors, particularly when we track it or we try and match it up with some of the skills gaps identification work you've been talking about. And I'm wondering whether, I know you said the skills inquiry is reporting next spring, but I'm wondering whether you can give us any indication of how, whose priorities will win out in those kinds of things, because you know the kinds of investment, the kind of approaches to both skills and supply chain issues for an energy economy are very, very different to the kinds of investment skills focus that we would need for hospitality, for instance. And they're going to be geographical, very distinct geographical tensions there. And I'm just wondering how you see those tensions and conflicts being resolved.
Yeah, but I think if you look at each of the eight REP areas, they've all got increasing sharpness of clarity around about their regional offer, right? The North East and the work that One has done on this and others, and we've worked with them and others on this, and the REP and others in the North East has got clarity around about clearly energy, but also food and drink and also tourism offer, so there's, and life sciences. So there's three or four areas that have real strengths. And you look at each part of Scotland, you can say, yeah, they are good at these three or four things and they're good at these three or four things. So I think that is really taking shape. And the skills pipeline, I think, and I'll ask Karen to comment perhaps on this in a minute, but the skills pipeline being aligned to that is important. But I think colleges get that. And they understand in the regional economy, the businesses and the sectors they work with, what's important in any given sector. And you're right, there'll be a range within there from very advanced PhD level jobs in the working with businesses that are focused on the biohub in Aberdeen, and there'll be other jobs in hospitality that are more entry level jobs, but very important jobs as well, that also require training to be able to fulfil them effectively in an increasingly digitised economy. So all of that has got a role to play, and I think it's fair to say that the work we're doing on the skills agenda is increasingly making sure that there is alignment both a Scottish level and a regional level on that. But Karen.
Thanks, Minister. Yeah, just to say that the NSET Skilled Workforce Programme really focuses in on aligning provision with the needs of employers, whether that's locally or nationally. There's a lot of work already underway through the Shared Outcomes Framework and various pieces of work that are leading into education and skills reform. The Minister mentioned the independent review of the skills delivery landscape, which will the independent lead is expected to make some recommendations in the spring. So all this work is really focused in on ensuring we have that pipeline of workers that we're going to need in the future.
Okay. I've got a couple of other questions, but maybe I can take those offline. I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. Colin Smith, followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thank you, Convener. Can I turn to the important role of government procurement in securing local supply chains? In response to the first question, Minister, you talked about how we built robust supply chains to deal with the pandemic. I want to touch on one example in a response to the pandemic. It's a company it's mentioned in a report, one you're very familiar with, which is Alfa Solway. We said in a quote, it was cited as an excellent example of a business working with the public sector to create a more sustainable and resilient supply chain. You visited the company a few months ago in Dumfries, and you're quoted as saying their expansion has created over 300 new jobs, underlying the importance of the manufacturing of vital PPE to our economic recovery. We don't want to say the 4.8 million South of Scotland Enterprise investment demonstrates a commitment to secure the long-term future of manufacturing in Scotland while showing how public and private sectors can collaborate to address challenges caused by the pandemic. But that company, as you know, Minister, has just shut one of its Dumfries plants, and there's not 300 jobs, there's actually just a dozen, and they no longer are producing PPE because the NHS in Scotland ended contracts for that. I understand it was one of the cuts announced by the government recently. Now, everyone accepts that demand for PPE was going to fall, including the company who are refocusing, but I don't think, including yourself, fully expected to see the absolute cliff edge that happened there, where contracts were pretty much ended overnight. So can I ask how decisions like that are going to show a commitment by the government to building resilient supply chains, particularly for a product such as PPE, which is a real challenge, as we saw during the pandemic, making sure that we have those local supplies that we need? Is that not a great example of building that long-term resilient supply?
Very much it is, and Alfa Solway did great work during the pandemic and after that, and we engaged very closely with them to understand the situation of the business. But the reality is that it's not as if we're buying PPE from somewhere else. We're buying PPE in Scotland, but it's not buying any PPE. And everybody understands that, because we're all sat here not wearing masks, and that wouldn't have been the case 6 months or a year ago. So the demand for PPE just isn't there. And obviously what we're not going to do is take public money and buy a product that's got a lifespan and put it on shelves and wait for it to expire when we don't need to do that. So the demand is the issue there. The strategic long-term intent is clear, and a big part of the investment that Alfa Solway's made with Scottish public sector support has been on their meltblown facility, which allows them to move further back up, vertically integrate further back up the supply chain, and puts them in a position where their supply chain is more resilient and not relying on others for material supply, and also puts them in a position where that facility with that significant investment is something that's there for the future. So as and when PPE requirements increase again, absolutely those conversations and those orders will start to flow again. I'm also very clear that if there's any other parts of the public sector that is outside of our scope that is continuing to purchase PPE from outside of the Scottish supply chain, I'd be very interested to have a conversation with them. So if there's any examples of that, and I've been very clear and written to the rest of the Scottish public sector to bring this to their attention, to understand if that is indeed happening, but we've seen no evidence of that happening anywhere else. I don't know, Graeme, if you want to comment on anything else with regards to the procurement aspects of that.
Well, the power of public sector procurement is a clear focus in public sector procurement policy, and local economic well-being is a cornerstone of procurement legislation in Scotland. And I've got a variety of different numbers, in terms of SME, Scottish third sector spend within Scotland that show the significant success. But there is an ongoing focus on securing the indigenous supply chains and growing them, as the Minister mentioned earlier, particularly through initiatives like the Supply Chain Development Programme.
I'll come back to the wider policy issue, but I do want to follow up on your comments about Alfa Solway, because you say that investment it gives them a base for the future, but that's not really much of a consolation to the workers who, at the height of the pandemic, basically put themselves at risk to produce the PPE that our nurses and doctors needed to keep safe, that they've now basically been made redundant and don't have a job in the short term because of that cliff edge, which absolutely nobody expected at all. Now, you said that we're just not buying PPE anymore. I mean, are you saying that there is no PPE at all in the public sector in Scotland being purchased at this moment in time? Because every time you walk into a hospital, you have to wear a face covering. Presumably the police are purchasing PPE. Presumably the fire service are still purchasing PPE. So why did you say, Minister, that nobody is purchasing PPE? Presumably they are. And if so, is all of that PPE being manufactured here in Scotland? It's being used in the public sector in Scotland.
Well, first of all, in terms of the position with the orders for Alfa Solway, without going into too much detail, orders would have been placed for demand, and then those orders would have had a lead time, but there would have been clarity of what there was no orders following on from that. So there was visibility of when the demand was going to stop. Clearly, in terms of usage, that's much reduced to what it was previously, as we all know. And of course, for strategic resilience and many other reasons, we're sitting on significant stockpiles of PP, and that is what is largely supplying the demand in the public sector at the moment. I've been very clear, and I've said this already, from the parts of the supply chain that we've got visibility on, be that Scottish Government, be it NSS through NHS Scotland and others, there's nothing being purchased at the moment so we could be supplying. I have written already to the rest of the public sector, where we don't have visibility, to ask them if anyone else is purchasing PPE, so we can have a conversation about what would need to be done for that to be manufactured in Alfa Solway. And to the best of my knowledge, there's no one else that is purchasing PPE beyond that Alfa Solway could manufacture. But if you're aware of it, or anyone else is aware of any examples of that, I'd be very interested to hear about it, to follow it up specifically. But we've been very proactive, both in terms of what we've done on the bits that we control and in terms of the very strong signals we've sent to the rest of the public sector about the critical importance of the Scottish supply chain and working with the public sector procurement to make sure that everything that can be made in Scotland is made in Scotland. But I think, I mean, I don't know if what you're asking me is that we should be spending public money to buy stuff we don't need to keep people in jobs. That may be a view, but I don't think the current situation with the requirements on, or the pressures on public sector finance, that would be a good use of public resource to buy stuff, keep it and then throw it away later on. I don't think that would make sense.
What I'm saying, Minister, is that I want an absolute assurance that all PPE that's used in the public sector in Scotland is actually manufactured here, and it seems that maybe the government are not entirely clear on that at the moment, because it does seem really surprising that just a few months ago you were talking about the creation of 300 jobs and all of a sudden that stopped. We all knew supplies would be reduced as we moved out of the pandemic. I don't think anybody expected that cliff edge, and I assume also yourself, given the comments you made just a few weeks ago about the future of that company. Certainly the workers that have lost their jobs weren't expecting that particular cliff edge. But I'm just curious, when it comes to our procurement rules, as to whether or not we think that they have been adequately changed to really increase the reliance or the focus on local supply chains, because it does seem to me that, if an example of PPE, it does suggest that maybe some is still being produced out with Scotland. That's a really example of where I think 100% should be absolutely produced in Scotland, but there'll be lots of other products that can be produced around the world, and I'm not clear that there's enough focus on our procurement rules to really emphasise that if it can be made in Scotland, it should be purchased by the public sector in Scotland. So, for example, if I'm a purchaser in a local authority or the police or the fire service, and I want to buy PPE, for example, does it absolutely say in that system where it's manufactured? Does it say it's supplied by a company in Scotland, but does it actually say where it's manufactured? How much information do we provide in where a product is manufactured, and how much emphasis do we put on ensuring the public sector, where they can, are absolutely buying products produced here in Scotland?
Absolutely we do, right, and I understand this stuff. I worked in manufacturing for 30 years, I understand how this works. We're 100% focused on this relentlessly. But you will also know that it's illegal to specify what you've just asked us to specify, because within WTO procurement rules, GPA rules, FTAs that we have internationally with the EU trade agreement, etc., etc., you have to have an open market. So we do everything we can to make sure that as much of this product is manufactured in Scotland. We make that visible. We produce guidelines on that, and we work very importantly, and this is the importance of that investment into Alfa Solway, to make sure that those businesses in that supply chain and other supply chains have the capacity, the capability, the expertise, the technology to be able to compete on what is a global market, to be able to win those contracts. And Alfa Solway have done a great job in winning those contracts. And they did that fair and square, beating competition from around the world. And that's because of the support, be it on training, on investment and elsewhere, that went into them from the Scottish public sector to support that. But all of this, as I said, has to be done within those rules. That's the legal reality of the system that we operate in. But as Graham alluded to, our success within this has been quite significant. Within Scotland, within SMEs in Scotland, 47% of the spend that we make in the public sector procurement in Scotland goes to SMEs in Scotland, which is significantly in advance of anything that's happening in the rest of the UK, where that number's in the 20s, and across the EU, where the average is somewhere in the 20% to high 20% range. So we've made significant progress there. The results demonstrate that, but the focus continues to be relentless on that, and we look for every opportunity, be it through the supplier development programme, through roundtables we have with SMEs to understand challenges for them to access the public procurement process, through working with partners across the public sector, through what we're doing on the innovation portal and the recent Scotland Innovates portal we've just launched, that invites Scottish businesses with innovative solutions to public sector challenges to put them online, so we can assess them and find a public sector procurement route for them, through the work that CivTech does putting out public sector challenges. So all of that stuff, we're relentless on it, we've got tremendous focus on it. I meet regularly with procurement officials to take that forward. And all of that is done, of course, as you understand, within the legal restrictions that we have.
But so what would be really helpful, Minister, is a follow-up response, because you said you're making inquiries, which it seems quite strange, so many years into a pandemic, you're making inquiries as to whether or not the public sector is right across the board purchasing PPE entirely within Scotland. I think it would be really helpful if you were able to write to the committee and explain what the outcome of your inquiries.
Absolutely.
To all
and we shall do that.
To give an assurance that it is all being absolutely...
Well, we don't have the power to tell a local authority, for
you
example.
You don't have the power to ask them. Well, I mean, I think that's maybe a debate that has to be had around, I mean, the police, for example, the fire service and others, which are national bodies now, and how much central approach we have to something as important as PPE. But what I think would be really helpful is to know that that product was absolutely 100% being purchased by the public sector from manufacturers in Scotland, and I think it would be good to get the outcome of your inquiries on that.
I will respond to the committee and let you know the outcome of that. As I say, we are, if a local authority decides to purchase something, we are not in a position to tell them where they should buy that from, and I think if we did that, there'd be others that would say that we shouldn't be doing that. So, but I've written out very clearly to make these points very strongly to all public sector authorities, and I will be very happy to update the committee on any responses we get in that regard.
Just before I bring in Ms Hislop, can I just ask, so 74% of contracts were Scottish through the public procurement system, which the committee welcomes. The committee did ask if the data could be improved, and we could see that by region or by a smaller base rather than just the whole of Scotland, because while we recognise the value of the contracts being awarded across the whole of Scotland, we wanted to see the potential for more value to local economies. Is it possible for that
information? Yeah, I'll ask Graham to pick up on the details on the data.
Thank you. So each year we publish the Scottish Minister's Annual Procurement Report. That includes breakdowns by local authority area of expenditure, public procurement expenditure. Breakdown by the SIMD quintile, that's the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation Classification, so we can see whether the money's going in terms of disadvantaged to relatively prosperous regions of Scotland. And we also publish the split between urban and rural classifications.
But does does that tell us, and if you could share that with us, that would be helpful. Does that tell us, for example, I represent Miss Scotland in five councils contracts, does that tell us if they're going to five companies, or does that tell us, you know, they're going to companies that are in more deprived areas, or does it, do you understand what I mean? Does it
so the annual report gives the figures by local authority area. It doesn't, the aggregate report doesn't give the detail by public authority. However, public authorities also have, within the Procurement Reform Act, the 2014 Act, a statutory duty to publish their own annual reports on where their expenditure is going, what they're doing to support SMEs, third sector, supported businesses, and economic growth, socioeconomic factors right across the piece.
Does anybody bring those two reports together? I think that the committee would maybe, that would put, think what we were looking for was probably the information in those two reports combined. But if you were able to share, I'll let Fiona Hislop in. If you were able to share maybe the reports you've referred to with the committee, that would be helpful.
Absolutely. The annual report does combine so that the Scottish Minister's annual report is the aggregation of all of the individual public reports, reports on public bodies from right across Scotland. The requirement kicks in at £5 million annual expenditure.
So anything below £5 million wouldn't be covered by the report?
Below £5 million, there isn't a statutory duty, but we do still encourage it nonetheless. We consider it to be best practice to publish an annual report.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Fiona Hislop to be followed by Jamie Halco-Johnson.
Good morning, and thank you, Minister, for your letter replying to our inquiry. And, of course, you gave evidence to this committee during the inquiry. So this is now the second time we're engaging with you on this resilience of the supply chain in Scotland, but it is a continuing issue, not least because of ongoing issues around COVID, as we've just heard, issues around the hard Brexit and also the impact of Ukraine. I want to focus particularly on manufacturing, engineering and construction. And we know that you can't micromanage private markets, and international obligations are understood. But we can create incentives and what we're interested in as a committee is to what extent has the experience of those disruptions that we talked about influenced change in the supply chain markets generally. If we cover construction, one of the things that we heard about was real disruptions over that period, but also a desire by the sector to be able to source more locally if they could. That's resilient, but also would contribute to net zero. So the issue around carbon miles. So what improvements have there been, particularly around timber? We've got a debate this afternoon on forestry and net zero, but improvements in sourcing of timber locally. And are we able to use business regulations? To what extent can you try and influence pan-government, things that can help in terms of business regulations and low-carbon materials? Mm-hmm. And what is the potential for some kind of specification of carbon miles that might have to be internationally agreed? Mm-hmm. But that's probably the direction we're going in.
Yeah, thanks for that. I'll let Dermot come in and talk specifically on more of the timber and broader stuff that we're doing in that regard. But on timber, that's one of the areas of focus in the Supply Chain Development Programme. In Scotland, we manufacture more of our housing stock from timber than is the case in the rest of the UK. We see opportunities there from an embodied carbon point of view to have to do yet more of that. There are technical issues, but the Construction Innovation Centre, BEST, over in Blantyre, is very much leading the way in terms of the research, working with universities and others on that, in terms of mass laminated products and products that are able to be utilised more extensively in the supply chain. I've engaged with sawmills and others in this regard as well, in terms of what they can do to increase output, etc. One of the issues of timber, of course, is it's probably perhaps the longest lead time item we've got. It's in a 30-year lead time, so it's a challenge from that perspective, because things, decisions you take now, you don't see the results for a very long time, although Scotland's coverage of forest continues to increase over time, which is to be welcome. But there's also other factors that it's worth mentioning, which maybe identify how complex this is. There's clearly a biodiversity challenge in terms of what species you choose to grow, because the species we might choose to grow to mass produce housing stock are not perhaps the species you might choose to grow, or that balance might not be what you might want from a biodiversity point of view. So that has to be considered, and that's part of the issue in terms of native species and so on, and getting that balance right is something we're all committed to. And then further downstream, the work that's happening with to my colleague Patrick Harvey and others are taken forward around about the heating buildings, the decarbonisation of property and so on, and the net zero agenda, making changes to regulation that encourage Scottish supply chain are absolutely a factor. But of course, the primary concern is always going to be making changes to regulation that deliver the best cost-effective solution for the net zero challenges. So again, getting that balance right is something that we're working across government on to make sure that it's balanced. But it's true to say that all of that work is happening to try and get that right balance and move forward as fast as we can.
And before you bring down the concept of carbon miles, as being, whether it's in the private sector or the public sector, becoming more of a factor, what engagement is there on that? Is that, because clearly it makes sense.
Yeah.
It will help deliver net zero. It's not just local, it's national, international. Yeah. But where are we in Scotland in looking at that issue in particular?
I'll let Graham comment on that specifically, but I think you're right, there's international work on that at EU level and elsewhere in terms of carbon mechanisms. There's always going to be a challenge there in terms of how far you can go with that before you hit other restrictions we've talked about in terms of WTO procurement rules, etc. But where there is scope, we're keen to move it forward. Graham, you maybe want to put some more detail on that. Thanks.
Yeah, so carbon miles can be considered as part of whole life carbon counting. You couldn't just isolate carbon miles from everything else in the lifetime of a product. That would be too close to a proxy of buy local, which would trip over the WTO rules. It is incredibly complicated to do whole life cycle carbon counting. And so it has to be done in a proportionate way to avoid putting an unreasonable burden onto particularly SME bidders. And counting according to mechanisms that haven't yet even been agreed internationally, it would be a sizeable burden on businesses bidding in for WACC. So absolutely, it can be done. It's complicated. But rather than count carbon particularly, Scottish public procurement policy takes a broader look, a more nuanced look, to see exactly what is being done to reduce environmental impact, including carbon, but also reducing waste, less use of rare earth elements, and so on.
So just because it's complicated and hard doesn't mean if it's the right thing to do, we don't have a look at it and see what we can do. I think you're going to bring in Dermot, and if possible, if there's anything additional on timber, but also on cement and how realistic this is. I mean, if we can crack cement from a kind of environmental impact, that's a dual hit of local supply.
Conversations with Scotland's cement industry.
Right, please share.
In terms of what we can do there. Yeah, and green cement is obviously an area of focus for the sector, and it's obviously a huge investment and technical challenge, but it's something we've had conversations with the sector in terms of how we move forward.
Well, Derek, do you want to?
The big cement works at Dunbar seen recent investment to reduce the amount of gas I think they're using there in their kilns. So individually, companies are making efforts there to reduce the carbon input to their processes. And also, I think that business at Dunbar too were making more use of the rail, so their product wasn't moving around so much on the road. The sector, I think, moving from materials that they know and understand to new materials, I think, is a bit of a challenge, because they have to give warranties to their, you know, the people they're selling to. So if they've been using materials, steel, cement, concrete, that they know, and then they're moving to wood or other things, there's a bit of thinking about that for them, because they're gonna grant warranties maybe for those buildings for 10 years or 20 years, and there's insurance implications, etc. So I think there is a bit of resistance to change, not always for bad reasons, but because people want to be convinced that the materials they're moving to are will do the job on site. There's great innovation going on through the Innovation Centre that's now called BEST. I mean, they are doing a lot with clients, with builders, other people, to show what new other materials can be used, particularly around timber. But I think it takes a while to change for that reason. I think particularly people having confidence in materials.
Which is why government can have a role, and what we're interested in is what's government doing, and clearly regulations and building regulations is potential. So we just want assurance that you're not just being passive in this, that there's an active role by government in this area.
No, and the Minister's been, you know, we're speaking all the time to people about things like what we could do in terms of specifying types of techniques for building, etc., etc. But all of those, you know, if we're going to make a change, they all do need to be evidence-based. So we have commissioned evidence on various things, which may lead to some changes in terms of what we might specify for our affordable housing programme, etc., etc. Yeah. But it's okay. All got to be based on evidence.
And can I just move on to manufacturing engineering? Yeah. And again, it's just to get a sense of to what extent has there been a step change because of those crises and the continuing crisis, you know, that we're facing, particularly from Brexit, etc., for engineering companies. And we got quite blunt kind of view, I think, from the chair of the National Manufacturing Innovation Centre, that over decades Scotland had lost some of the key manufacturing and engineering skills. So therefore, if we are trying to build resilience, but also in the areas for growth, not least in renewable energies, there's quite a lot of development that would need to be taken. And also looking at their work in low carbon, to what extent has there been a shift of the dial by their impact and the number of companies they're working with, and how do we tackle that particular challenge around manufacturing and engineering, which, you know, is quite clear that centralisation across the UK or indeed internationally has meant that we don't do as much of this kind of work as we would have done previously. And the issue is, we can't micromanage everything, but to what extent does that mean helping those companies develop?
So just to finish on the last point, there's work ongoing on building regulations. There's a new 2024, the new building heat standards getting put into place. There's work happening on that all the time, and those standards have been updated to take account of the factors we've talked about. In terms of manufacturing, well, it's been the decline in manufacturing has been a long-term issue in Western economies, but particularly in the UK over decades. As we know, it was an issue when I studied manufacturing engineering in 1980, and it continues to be an issue. But in terms of what we are doing about it, it's important to recognise that these aren't things that you turn on like a switch. It takes a long time. The technology, the investment, the expertise, the accreditations, the market credibility, all that stuff takes a long time to build up. And from our perspective, it's about identifying where Scotland has the opportunity to have globally leading positions in specific manufacturing sectors, and then to double down and support and build on that, both through a combination of investment, but very importantly as well through growing Indigenous supply chains and businesses in partnership with that. And if you look at some examples, I mean, an obvious one is the small satellite manufacturing cluster, which has been built up over the last decade or two, and is now a world-leading sector, and we continue to get additional investment into that, continue to grow those businesses, but a really strong focus from all parts of the public sector support ecosystem to support that. The ScotWind investment we've talked about. There's £28 billion committed by developers. To be honest, the issue isn't getting the developers to commit the money. The issue is getting finding somewhere to spend it, because you need £28 billion worth of capacity in the Scottish supply chain to deliver on those projects. And that is something we're actively working with hundreds and hundreds of businesses, engineering businesses in Scotland, who are part of the clusters within the sector, and very much working with Scottish Engineering and others for engineering businesses who haven't looked at energy supply chain as being an opportunity for them and are in other sectors to diversify into that. And that's going to be a combination of information, encouragement, skills support, investment support, networking, accreditation, etc., all of that needs to click to get this thing to work, and we're hugely focused on it, and NMIS is doing a very solid job at the centre of that ecosystem, but there's much else happening round about it as well to make that deliverable.
And just finally, sure. On that, I mean, what we hear from the engineering sector in particular is they may not get contracts for 5 years, but they have to build that capacity and start building that capacity now. So I suppose the issue then becomes what, if anything, the public sector can do to provide, I suppose it's that bridge. It's almost like a bridging development to allow them to build up the capacity, the skills in their companies, ready to make sure they get their share of that for those contracts, some of which will come sooner, some of which will come later, but they might not come for some time. So that's the role of the public sector, to build that resilience. Otherwise, we won't have the supply chain that we obviously want.
Yeah, absolutely. Specifically in Scotland, yeah. Well, I think there's a number of parts to that. There's the big international players who absolutely understand this, and they're dealing with that, but their investment decisions on what they're going to make in Scotland, what they're going to make elsewhere, is driven by a number of factors. So I was giving them the reassurance and as much clarity as we can in what is a very complicated scenario with lots of moving parts, because consenting, planning, grid connections and a whole range of other things all impact this, as well as the supply chain aspects and the energy aspects of it. So that's part of it. There's many, many businesses, pretty much every business now, at least 80% of the businesses in the oil and gas sector are moving into renewable energy in the supply chain. So we work closely with them to give them information and the technology and the connected into the network so that they're able to take advantage of that. And then there are other businesses and other sectors that we're supporting to move into that. But it's a complicated piece, you're right. Businesses in some cases are going to have to make investment decisions in advance of knowing what's going to happen. And through the work that we are doing, that the enterprise agencies are doing with support for that, the Scottish National Investment Bank in some cases is doing, and they're working with private sector investors, we're keen to be able to make sure that where there is a gap, and there's something needing done to make sure the supply chain is robust and ready, we're proactively engaged at quite a detailed level to make that happen.
And that would that be you or Michael Matheson who'd be the lead on that?
We worked together on that. We had a call just this evening, yesterday evening, specifically on this issue and how we align the work of the public sector to support that. So Michael leads on the energy side of it clearly, but my involvement in the supply chain is where I kind of pick it up.
Thank you very much, Minister.
Thank you. And I have one member left to ask questions, which is Jimmy Hogle-Johnson.
Thank you. Good morning to the Minister and to his team. The committee's conclusion 6 in our report featured some criticism of the cluttered landscape of policy commitments, funding streams and initiative to transition to net zero. In the Scottish Government's response, you mentioned that, and I quote, bespoke advice and support for businesses, including specific support for SMEs, is also available through enterprise agencies, Zero Waste Scotland, Business Gateway and the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. And you also went on to discuss the investment in the Green Jobs Fund, the Green Jobs Skills Hub and so on. So can I ask you, Minister, does this not sound like part of the problem of a cluttered landscape rather than an answer to it?
We are very conscious of the fact that we need to make sure there's clarity on funding streams from government and from agencies, and that we are aligning and minimising the any potential for confusion or clutter within that. One of the actions within the national strategy is specifically on that, to look at business support and understand where there are funds that are doing similar jobs and how we reduce the number of funds, or to make sure it's the right number of funds to deliver what we need to deliver, and don't make that landscape any more clutter than it needs to be. It's important to recognise, of course, that different businesses are looking for different types of support for different types of challenges, and they're in different sectors. We're focused on different challenges and opportunities. So to some extent, there will be a number of support mechanisms, but we're absolutely seized of the fact that we need to make that as simple as possible, both from a business perspective, so they can navigate it more easily, but also from a public sector perspective, to make sure that it's as efficient as possible on the delivery. Dermot is with others is working on specifically on a programme to streamline those funding streams. So if you want to get into more detail, happy to talk more on that, but if that's something you want to do.
Well, I mean, it sounds encouraging that you are looking at ways of streamlining. Perhaps it would be useful if we could perhaps get an update from you at some point about, you know, how that's progressing and what, whether that does deliver a more streamlined process.
Delighted to do that.
Okay, thanks. I also wanted to look at some of the issues and get some clarifications on issues around SDPR and infrastructure. I'm sure that you will recognise, as Business Minister, the importance of dualling of the A9 between Inverness and Perth, as well as the dualling of the A96, and that these are vital public infrastructure projects that could have a massive boost to the north of Scotland, particularly my Highlands and Islands region. In a debate last week, your colleague, Jenny Velruth, the Minister for Transport, said that the Scottish Government was still committed to dualling both roads as promised. Can you just confirm that is the case and there'll be no downgrading of these commitments on either road?
Far be it from me to criticise the mess of responsibility for that policy area. So I think what the Transport Minister said stands. But I'm going to ask Andy just to comment more specifically on the projects.
Yeah, so both of those projects came from Strategic Transport Projects Review 1, as you'll be aware. And we're about to publish the final report for STPR 2, which will build on an additional programme of investment for the next 20 years. After we've published STPR 2, we're going to publish a delivery plan which will combine the bits of STPR 1 that aren't finished yet, if you like, with the recommendations of STPR 2. Initially, the hope was to publish that at the same time as the SDPR final report, but given the kind of uncertainty over future capital budgets, the likely plan at the moment is that will be published. The delivery plan will be published some point probably in the spring, when there's greater clarity over capital budgets. The rationale being that if we publish the delivery plan now before the Scottish budget was finalised for next year, then we'd probably have to change it given the great deals of great amount of financial uncertainty. That's not completely locked in yet, but likely. And that will cover existing projects, including the A9 and A96.
Okay, thanks for that. Well, it was those bits that aren't finished yet, if I can quote you, that interested me, because, Minister, you'll be aware that there's been slow progress on both of these projects. A9 dualling is meant to be completed by 2025, and it's clear to anyone that target date's not going to be met. But we've not heard that yet from the Scottish Government, despite it being, say, obvious to anybody who uses the road. So can you also confirm that the 2025 target will be missed, and also confirm whether or not a revised timetable for completion is being prepared and will be delivered as part of that new delivery plan for April next year?
As I indicated, this is obviously outside of my portfolio area. The Transport Minister has commented on that, and what I will do is invite the Transport Minister to respond to your specific questions on that, rather than me talking from a position of not having the full information, as it's outside my portfolio. So I'll do that as a matter of course following on from this meeting, and if you want to put any request on that in writing, I'm sure you should be delighted to answer your questions.
Well, I'm grateful for that. I mean, this is an issue that's been raised a number of times with various ministers over the last few months and maybe longer in terms of the delivery. I mean, from a business point of view, as I say, you all recognise how important that road is to the Highlands, those roads are to the Highlands and Islands, and particularly the A9 to the Highlands and further beyond, all the way through to Orkney, where I'm from. And yet we haven't had that confirmation that within 2.5 years, the entirety of the road, you know, was meant to be dual. You know,
Sorry, Mr. Halkwell-Johnson, sorry to interrupt, but I think you've made your point well and the Minister has given a response. I don't think the additional question is going to get a different response from the Minister. So if there's another area you wish to ask about, I can give you another question, but if not, I'll...
Well, no, I was trying to get a clarification on something that's vital in part.
I do appreciate that, but I think... Sorry, I do... I do appreciate that, and I appreciate you taking the opportunity to raise it at the committee, but I think the Minister has indicated that he would ask the Transport Minister to give us a response on the specifics of that, and he's not placed this morning to give you the guarantee or the commitment that you're looking for. I don't think we'll get any further on this point. So if there was any other issue you wish to raise, I can give time to do that, but if not, I'll move on.
No, this was the area that was covered in the report that I was interested in, and I was looking to get clarification, but OK.
OK, thank you very much. Just before we thank the Minister for we have run over time a little bit, can I just briefly return to where we started, which was the Supply Chain Development Programme. The committee's inquiry was prompted by disruptions to supply chains, and we were looking at, I think Ms Hislop picked up on some of these issues, how do we put resilience into the system that will deal with disruptions? Because the Supply Chain Development Programme does seem more focused on developing new supply chains, supporting supplier development, but maybe not so much on how do we make sure we're a country that is fit and able to respond to things that are unexpected, that are shocks to our economy. You know, you think these things are never going to happen, but we've had three in the last few years. Would it be the Supply Chain Development Programme that's the focus for looking at that, or is it somewhere else in government that is looking at those kind of events and how we respond to
it? Well, there's a number of parts of government that will be looking at that. You're right, the Supply Chain Development Programme will look at opportunities to build Scotland's economic capacity and onshore and establish robust supply chains within Scotland, where we recognise we've got the capability to be able to compete globally and build Indigenous industries on the back of that. Clearly, if we're talking about something happens and there's a risk to food supply or something, then that's the resilience work within SCORE and within the Scottish Government group led by the DFM Deputy First Minister that would look at those specific very short term resilience issues if there was a concern about, as I say, food supply or some other aspect of that that was going to impact the country in the very short term, and that the same group that would look at other disaster recovery type aspects as well.
Okay, thank you. If it's very brief, Mr. Simpson, I can.
It's for clarity, because it's for something that Mr. Park mentioned, and that was the STPR2 delivery plan, which is actually mentioned in the Minister's response to the committee. In your response, you say that delivery plan will be published later this year. Mr. Mm-hmm. Park has just said that there's slippage on that. He used the phrase spring, which can mean quite a bit. You know, can you? People are actually been waiting for this for some time, and the committee's report does refer quite heavily to the road network, which is why Mr. Halker-Johnson was asking about it. But so can you say why is the slippage, and when exactly are we going to see this?
It's actually relatively straightforward. The original publication date was based on what we thought was the certainty of the resource spending review and the revisiting of the capital spending review in the spring. So this is, and so whereas the various changes over the summer have happened and the greater uncertainty around budgets, it's the decision has been recommended that we delay publication of a plan until we have certainty over budgets. So the STPR2 final report with the recommendations will come out before Christmas, but the plan itself needs the certainty of knowing what future capital budgets are, otherwise we'd probably have to rewrite it within 3 months. So it's, yeah, it's... Yeah.
Well, you're getting support from SNP members, that's not surprising. So he's saying it would be out by March?
I'm not giving a date. I was saying it will be delayed until after... It won't come out until after Christmas, after the Scottish budget has been set and we know what capital allocations are for the immediate few years, which we don't at the moment. It was in a position where it could have been published before Christmas, but it is... it just makes no analytical or practical sense to do that now, because we don't have that certainty. We will perhaps have a little bit more certainty next week, but until that feeds through budget processes, it's fairly straightforward. If we published it now, we'd be revising it as soon as we knew what the money was.
Okay.
Apologise for the chuntering in the background.
Thank you. Thank you. It now brings us to the end of the evidence session. I thank the Minister and his officials for attending this morning. I now move into private session.
Thank you very much.